Dr. Nicholas Weisskopf from the Max Planck Institute for Human Cognitive and Brain Science. Now, he's going to tell us about real-time fMRI neurofeedback. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks a lot for the kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this very interesting and exciting conference. And what I'd like to do, I'd like to take you through a little journey of real-time fMRI neurofeedback, which is a rather new technology. So it's about 15 years old by now and has already made its way from fundamental neuroscience into the first clinical trials. So I'm glad that Jack Gallant already introduced very nicely the concept of functional MRI, fMRI. So that's quite helpful. I don't need to spend too much time on that, but I will still briefly introduce that, explain to you what we mean by real-time fMRI, what's different to fMRI, and how we use it for neurofeedback. Then talk and guide you through a typical neurofeedback experiment. And I hope you will take away here mainly the concept, how people approach that, how people use this technology. And then I will continue in giving you a few examples of how that can be leveraged to basically change the brain and manipulate behavior. And last but not least, I will just conclude the talk. So, When you look at that slide, that's actually the reason why I got into neuroscience and neuroimaging, the top left graph. When I opened up as a young graduate student a book on PET imaging, I saw these images of looking into the brain non-invasively and actually monitoring cognitive processes. I found this completely fascinating that you can do this, and it was clear for me that I would like to go into this area, and my excitement even increased when I saw then on the right side the functional MRI images that are acquired much faster, give you a higher tempo temporal resolution. But obviously, over the last 20 years, the development didn't stop there. But nowadays, we have much faster technologies. We can acquire data very rapidly in less than a second. And we can also acquire data with a very high spatial resolution now, below 1 millimeter. And in particular, the speed we are going to exploit for real-time fMRI. So what does that mean, real-time fMRI? Well, here is just a cartoon of that, how that would look like. For example, you put a subject into the MRI scanner. They look at the screen. They see maybe a visual stimulation or a movie, as we've seen it before. Then the MRI scanner will record the so-called BOLT signal, the blood oxygen level dependent signal. So that's an indirect measure of the neuronal activity. And keep in mind, that also means it's delayed and it's a relatively sluggish response, and that will become important later on. Then the scanner reconstructs the images, and we do some data analysis online while the scanner acquires the data, and importantly, we do that faster than the processing time of the analysis is shorter than the data acquisition time. So we stay on time, and every time we acquire a data point, let's say every second or every other second, we get a statistical result, a statistical map. And this is quite challenging because obviously you need quite a bit of computational power, the right algorithms, because usually it would involve the kind of processing as it is depicted here. So lots of different analysis steps involved. I just would like to give you one example here. This is a visual experiment, presentation of houses and faces to a subject. And this is an actual real-time analysis, actually now running faster just in the interest of time than in real time, so to say. You can see axial slices through the brain. You can see how the operator can in real time define regions of interest. You can see activity levels in the posterior part of the brain, the back of the brain, due to the visual stimulation. And you will see later on the operator will actually go in and interrogate that now in real time and ask questions about, are there specific responses in particular brain areas, maybe towards the faces, towards the houses, so to identify the fusiform face area and the parahippocampal place area in that case. What I'd like to bring across with the movie is that now this is possible to do all this in real time. You don't need to take the data offline. You can also see, especially in the beginning of the movie, you could see that the statistical maps had a very poor quality because we had very little data available at that time. So the results improve. The more data you can accumulate, the more information you have, the better and the more stable the results are. The other thing you can see on the right-hand column, you can see if I run it again, you will see on the right-hand side the region of interest time course. So you can see the actual bold response in the region of interest selected by the operator. And what you can see there, that it's delayed compared to the visual presentation indicated by the colored bars. So you can see in real time already the delay in the hemodynamics. So obviously, when you look at that, one of the first applications that probably comes to mind of real-time fMRIs, you could say, well, this is basically a brain-computer interface. So why don't we try to read the brain, to decode the brain, for example? And we've seen beautiful examples in the talk before. So here, this is kind of a simpler approach in the sense that subjects were trained to get into the particular brain states. Imagine, for example, inner speech or did motor imagery. So to achieve particular patterns in brain activity that can be then scanned in real time, identified in real time, and decoded in real time. And now, if you combine that with a kind of a spelling device, you can actually use that to transfer information to select letters, and that's exactly what researchers in Maastricht around Rainer Goebel have done. So they could decode, for example, letter information in about 1 minute per letter in the MRI scanner. But the actual reason why we got into that field about 15 years ago was to take this one step further and use it for neurofeedback. Here you can see this example again of the real-time fMRI setup, but nothing holds you back from closing the loop. So actually taking now the information you have analyzed and the information about the local brain activity you have gleaned from fMRI and feeding it back to the subject. And this will offer the subject now kind of an additional sense, a sense of their own local brain activity. And then via that kind of additional kind of perceptive mode they have now, they can actually learn to regulate that brain activity. And you could imagine this is maybe some form of operant conditioning here that helps you to learn self-regulation. So now you could ask, why is that important? I mean, why is it so interesting to learn self-regulation? Well, first of all, it's great fun. Try it out. It's fantastic. It's a good thing to do, to see your own brain working. But actually, in terms of this scientific goal here, what you can do, you can change the way how we run classic neuroimaging experiments. Usually, we have a certain behavior, or we apply a stimulus, like a painful electric stimulus here, and then we record with, for example, functional MRI, the corresponding neuronal activity. So it's kind of going from behavior to neuronal activity. But if we have learned control of neuronal activity, we can turn around this experiment and swap the variables. And now we can look at behavior dependent on neuronal activity. And you might be more familiar maybe with other techniques that do that, like transcranial magnetic stimulation, or pharmacotherapy is also a way to do that. But if you compare to the more physiological process of neurofeedback, obviously neurofeedback is more localized. And for example, compared to TMS, we can look at much deeper brain areas, which are very difficult to reach or not possible to reach with transcranial magnetic stimulation. And I would like to give you now an example of an experiment we've been doing. Here we looked at, we tried to keep it very simple, so we looked at brain areas where we know the functional role quite well. We know how to localize these brain areas in the individual using functional localizers of finger opposition or presentation of images in houses, and that will give us the supplementary motor area for the motor task and the parahippocampal place area for the faces versus houses contrast. And on the right side, you can see that depicted, these two different areas. So what we did next is then we selected these two areas here, the red and the blue box, and we called it the mean bold activity from them. We took these two mean bold activities levels and subtracted them from each other and presented that difference to the subject, to the volunteer. And this is basically a differential feedback because it's the difference of two activity levels in two regions of interest. On the right side, you can see the feedback screen that was presented to the subject. On the left side, the experimental screen here. And I will just run through the experiment here briefly. What you can see is where the arrows pointed up, the subject was asked to increase the level of activity. In the blue blocks, where the arrows point down, to decrease it. And this was after a little while of training. You can see that they actually could control the activity level. And this is real data, what I'm showing to you here. And we did this in a group of subjects. You can see that across 7 subjects that over time, over several days of training, so these are really intensive training experiments, the neurofeedback experiments, they actually started to learn to control this differential activity. And more importantly, on the right side of that graph, you can see that they were also able to control the activity levels in a so-called transfer run, where we did not present any feedback to them anymore. Moreover, we could do mapping and ask the question, how did they control the activity? And indeed, by regulating the SMA, as you can see at the bottom, and the PPA, even though we would have not penalized them for co-regulating other areas, it seems to be a fairly specific training effect happening here. Now, the important thing is, since they have now learned to regulate that without feedback, you can actually do behavioral tests. And I'll just show one of them we have done. This is an incidental memory encoding task where subjects were put into the scanner. They saw the same screen as before, but without feedback information, so just a task indicator to upregulate and downregulate the activity. While they did that, words were presented to them. Some of them were pseudo words, some of them were real words. Whenever they saw a pseudo word, they had to press a button. And this was actually just a distraction task, because what they did not know is that we'll ask them later on, 20 minutes after that run, we'll ask them whether a word was presented or not in the previous run. And what we found is that indeed, depending on whether they upregulated or downregulated, so everything was the same except for that regulation, they remembered the words better or not as well, as you can see on the left side. So this is an indication for a specific behavioral effect induced by local self-regulation, learned by neurofeedback. Now I'd like to give you a few more examples of how these techniques have been leveraged over the years. And this is really a rapidly developing field. So by no means this is kind of a full review or anything like that. It should just give you a flavor of what can be done. So one of the studies we've done here, we trained volunteers to regulate now the activity in the visual cortex and specific to a particular quadrant in the visual field of view. So one of the bottom quadrants. You can selectively localize these areas in the brain. You can train them, and they were trained to upregulate the activity. Why did we do this? Well, because we knew from previous studies that an increased activity in that area should actually support the detection of stimuli, should improve the perception. And so after the training, you can see it on the right side, in the transfer runs, they were actually able, again, to control the activity without neurofeedback. A control group trained with another area were not able to do that. So importantly, the neurofeedback was essential to achieve that control. And then we presented low-level gratings in different parts of the visual field of view. And indeed, whenever they upregulated the right quadrant and we presented a stimulus in that quadrant, they more easily detected that. So they relatively improved their perception and visual sensitivity for this particular quadrant. So you can see that there's, again, a behavioral consequence of the self-regulation here. You can also take this into the more clinical domain. This is from a collaborator in the EU Brain Train project, David Linton in Cardiff, where they trained patients suffering from depression to regulate brain areas that were related to seeing positive stimuli versus negative stimuli. And again, they could learn to regulate these brain areas, as you can see on the bottom left. Again, it took quite a while. I mean, we talk about here 4 sessions over 4 weeks to learn that. But interestingly, after they have learned the regulation of these areas, you can see on the right side that actually on the depression scale, the HDRI scale, they scored lower than a control group. The control group just did imagery of positive emotions. So in the control group, you didn't see any change. So this was the first indication towards effectiveness in the clinical domain. But keep in mind here, they did not have a control group in the MRI scanner. So the control group was only trained outside the MRI scanner. Then the last experiment I'd like to show you is an ongoing experiment here where we train at UCL, my former group in London, patients suffering from Huntington's disease, early forms or pre-manifest forms. We train them to regulate supplementary motor activity, supplementary motor area activity, because it's part of the motor circuit, which is affected early on. And you can see that, again, they learned to regulate that area. They also improved in terms of their cognitive and motor scores, as you can see on the bottom right. And interestingly, you can now ask the question, why did they do this? And because we have fMRI of the whole brain, we can look at connectivity, for example, in the motor system, which improved over training. And also improved then the composite scores. And on the right side, importantly, you can see there were anatomical changes related to that. So there's true plasticity induced here. And I'd like to mention that we are not the only group doing this. There's also a group by Heidi Johnson-Berg in Oxford who looked at similar things, and they showed changes in fractional anisotropy and diffusion measurements in neurofeedback of the motor system. So here I would like to wrap up. I hope I could bring across to you that real-time fMRI provides the exciting possibility to look at current ongoing bold activity, that it helps you to and enables you to learn self-regulation of specific brain areas, induces or may induce specific behavioral effects. On the bottom, you can see some examples of studies of various areas that have been trained. You can see it, a lot of the brain has been covered so far, and there are even more out there now. What is next? In terms of the neuroscience, I think understanding of the self-regulation mechanisms is really important. Also, what are the anatomical and physiological consequences? There's a lot of groundwork still to do in terms of fundamental neuroscience. In the clinical domain, it's really about how do we bring this into clinics? What are the best targets? And more importantly, also clinical trials are absolutely necessary to show the efficacy of, the, of these methods. And one of the big projects targeting those is the Brain Train project, involving several collaborators looking at mental disorders and training of in mental disorders. And on the technological side, there's a lot of interesting things happening in terms of faster fMRI acquisitions, prospective motion correction, as you can see it on the bottom right, which can help you a lot to stabilize your data, avoid artifacts. Then people started looking at network and connectivity feedback, and also multimodal approaches. So by no means are we restricted to use real-time fMRI only, but we can also use pharmacological interventions, TMS, and all that in parallel. Obviously, this is a lot of work. I'd like to thank the collaborators who have helped with that, my former group in London, my new group in Leipzig, and in particular, Rainer Goebel, who was an excellent, crucial collaborator over the years, and Niels Bierbaumer, who brought me into this field as my PhD supervisor at that time. And I would like to thank you for your attention.